Hello, everyone. Thank you so much for coming out on Friday night, beautiful Friday night, to kick off our 2016-2017 lecture series. Thank you. I'm Michael Ellsworth of Civilization. This is my partners, Corey Gutch and Gabriel Stromberg. And so we do these events to not only celebrate our design heroes, but to try to spark some conversation and dialogue in our community. And tonight we're really excited about our guest. He's an artist, designer, and activist who's sparked movements and conversations and actions all around the world. And his work is very inspiring to us and his ethos as well. So I'm very honored that he joined us tonight and to speak and share some stories with us. So I'm gonna turn it over to Corey to talk about what's going on this evening. And hope to see you all at the after party at Hotel 1000.
So we just want to take a moment to thank our sponsors, our main sponsor, MailChimp, and then Reach Now, who actually has wrapped an electric car that's parked across the street with the Design Lecture Series graphics. It's pretty cool. And for this event's being live streamed and archived, but for anyone who's in the audience, you see this season we've done these large format programs, which would not have been possible without the help from Color Plan, Legion Paper, and our favorite printer, Printing Control. So, and then thanks to all of our sponsors, we've been able to keep this lecture series free for everyone involved. Sponsors include Design Within Reach, Umpqua, Moleskine, the Public Library, ESOP, a whole bunch that are on this page of your program. So please take a look at these sponsors and buy things from them or whatever. So basically everyone from the last spread. So following Emory's lecture, we're going to have a Q&A, so please tweet your questions for Emory Douglas and our special guest moderator, Marissa Janae Johnson, at hashtag design lectures. And at the end of the night, Peter Miller will be selling some books, and Emory will be selling prints. It looks like some people got some earlier, and there's still more to buy, so thanks.
Our distinguished guest tonight has a body of work that has been described as revolutionary, brilliant, masterful. Just last year, the American Institute of Graphic Arts bestowed on him its highest honor, the AIGA Medal. And in summarizing his contribution to the history of graphic design, they used words like fearless and powerful. And in the accompanying statement to his 2009 retrospective at the New Museum, curator Laura Hauptmann described his signature approach as dangerous and meant to change the world. Well, through his role as designer, artist, and activist, he has done just that. Created decades of work that has activated communities and inspired change. As Minister of Culture for the Black Panther Party, he was the art director and main designer of the organization's official newspaper for over a decade, with a circulation of over 140,000 worldwide. His bold, unforgettable designs reached an audience that spanned the globe and positioned him as a cultural visionary of historic significance. Please join me in welcoming Emory Douglas.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. I would like to start off by saying all power to the people. And I'm going to talk this evening in regards to the images, give you some insight behind some of the images I've created, past and present. And it's going to be showing some of the more historical images in the beginning, and as we get to the latter part of the presentation, you will see more recent images done since in the 2000s, and some remixes of more historical ones as well. But first of all, I would like to give you an understanding, a little understanding of where the symbolism of the Panther comes from. It was in 1965, when the Voters' Rights Act was passed, You had, in Lowndes County, Alabama, you had a black community, sharecroppers predominantly, couldn't read or write, who had been intimidated all their lives in relationship to voting. And so you had a lot of the activists from that period who went to the South to enlighten and educate them about their voting rights. In Lowndes County, the county was a county of 20,000. 80% of it was black. The 20% races ran the county itself. And what happened, they didn't want to be a part of the Democratic Party nor the Republican Party. So they started an organization called the Lowndes County Freedom Organization. And in order to be a part of the be a political organization, you had to have an icon. So they chose the Panther as an icon. How did that come about? Well, they seen these high school sports teams, and you seen the Lions, the Tigers, and all those other things, animals. And the Panther was a symbol that they chose. So that became the symbol, comes up from the South during the Civil Rights Movement. This is the actual symbol, the first symbol of the Panther, one man, one vote. And this was the crop. This was the symbol of the Democratic Party, the white racists who ran the Democratic Party then. Here is that actual photograph of a young man. This is pre-Black Panther Party for Self-Defense, which became Black Panther Party, in Lowndes County, Alabama. And it says, vote November 8th, pull the lever for the Black Panther, and go home. and because of the fact it wasn't a reading community, it learned through observation and participation. At the ballot box, you had the icon, so that when those who couldn't read would know who to vote for. This is one of the earlier images. I start off with this one simply for one reason, was because of this was the first pig drawing. I was given this by Huey Newton to include in the paper, the maybe third or fourth paper of the Black Panther. And the reason why it was done is because of this particular badge number was the police was notoriously known in the community to intimidate and abuse his rights in relationship to protecting the community. And there were many others. But, and it just so happens that this was the badge number of the policeman named Fry who got into confrontation with Huey Newton, another Panther, and was killed in that confrontation when Huey Newton went to prison and was eventually exonerated of the murder. In the early days, we used to work in a studio apartment, just a regular table, regular light, very basic materials that we had to develop the newspaper. And Eldridge and Huey and them used to talk about the pig and defining what the pig was. And so this is the definition that they came up with: a low-natured beast that has no regard for law, justice, or the right of people, a creature that bites the hand that feeds it, a foul, depraved traducer, usually found masquerading as the victim of an unprovoked attack. So that became the definition of the policeman, the symbolic definition. Early on also, Eldridge Cleaver, which is, became the Minister of Information of the Black Panther Party, was invited to UC Berkeley to do, they wanted him to, the student body wanted him to come and teach. But then Ronald Reagan was the governor of the state of California, who eventually became the president of the United States, put pressure on the UC Board of Regents not to allow Eldridge Cleaver to speak at university. And so that was why we call Ronald Reagan a pig. Speaking as the racist governor of California, I don't think Eldridge Cleaver should teach at UC. So this became an issue. You had a lot of hundreds of thousands of students who protested at the university regarding this issue at that time. And also, this is the first Panther, as you may see in the back. His name was Little Bobby Hutton. He was 16 years old when he joined the party. Matter of fact, Huey Newton and Bobby Seale mentored him and had to get permission from his mother for him to join the Black Panther Party. And they mentored him prior to his 16th year, when he was prior to his 16th birthday. He was shot and murdered by the Oakland police April 1968, 4 days after, I think 4 days after Dr. Martin Luther King was killed in Memphis, Tennessee. So it had to be 1960. 4 days after. Anyway, this is when we began to call for community control of police, and having an oversight of the police. Before that, there was no talk or discussion about that. We got the Berkeley City Council representatives to support that issue. They got it on the ballot, and the people voted on it, but it lost by one vote. But it brought to attention the need for an oversight committee, but not what we see today, where the police want to have the oversight, where they reviewing themselves. It needs to be the community itself. Here again is an image that deals with when our officer shot up, when Huey Newton was got into conflict with the police, and the one who was killed, and he was exonerated, eventually let out of prison. We knew that something may happen that evening, but we weren't sure what it was. So we got all the kids, family, everybody out to office. And sure enough, that evening, the police came by and just sprayed the office. They shot it up. The next day, the chief of police, Chief Gaines, said, well, they were just frustrated over the verdict. And they weren't fired from the police department. They were only suspended with pay for about 6 months or something like that. This is just called justice. Some images I will talk in detail, others I will just show them to you, because there's quite a few, and hopefully we can get through all of them this evening. Here was one called Pigs Run Amok, and as we go along, there will be, if you feel like laughing, it's okay, no problem. This one's called Pigs Run Amok. This is based on the time when I was out organizing with Kathleen Cleaver and Elder Cleaver. We came back to the house that evening in San Francisco. The police knocked on the door. Eldridge Cleaver asked who it was. He said the San Francisco police. He asked, did you have a search warrant? And they said no. If they had a search warrant, there's no problem. They could come into our houses. We had nothing to hide. It would have been legal. But since they didn't have one, Eldridge told them, well, you have to kick the fucking door in because we're not letting you in. Excuse my language, young man. and so they began to kick the door in. And it was that, and the reason for that was because Elder Cleaver was a parolee. He wasn't allowed to have a gun in his possession, but there had been a lot of threats on him and his wife's life. So what they had got, consulted with the lawyers, our lawyers, and the lawyer said, well, Kathleen could purchase a gun in her name, but he couldn't have it in his name. And so obviously what they were doing, they were trying to come in to find if they could see some illegal guns that would have been in violation of Elders Cleaver's parole, and they could have sent him back to prison. But that wasn't the case. So I'm there just observing the situation, and I came up with this interpretation of it, where you have the pig saying, what are we looking for? And you got the other one with the question mark. You got the word pig with a snort looking under the rug. Then you got the other one with a snort in the tortoise bowl saying, where are the guns? And so it was a month later or so that they went to Bobby Seale's house in Berkeley, California, and it did the same thing. It was thereafter that we wrote this executive mandate number 3, where we said, in essence, and making it short, in Chicago, the Al Capone gang dressed up like police. They ran across town, and the other gang thought some of them were real police. So they put their hands up, and they slaughtered them. So we say, we don't know if you're real police or not coming to our doors without a search warrant. So we have to treat you like outlaws. And it was thereafter that we began to have these shootouts with the police all across the country, because then they began to infiltrate the party with agent provocateurs to create situations where there was these shootouts across the country. This is 1968. This was a high, intense year. You had many, many rebellions, over 300 rebellions inside the United States in 1968. You had the war in Vietnam, you had many rebellions inside the country, so it was nowhere to, it was hell outside, hell inside, nowhere to run and nowhere to hide. And I used America with 3 Ks, KKK. It wasn't something that I initially created, but I thought it was relevant to use with this illustration. It's all the same, the local police, National Guard, the Marines. We see that today with the Homeland Security. Everything comes under Homeland Security. When they come into our community, they come in as occupying forces. They come in that formation, as we know from Ferguson, and seeing with the tanks and the snipers and all those things in relationship to how what formations they come in to our community. They don't come into our communities as peacemakers or peace officers talking to the community. They always come in force, in formation. Here again, 1968, when we coined the word Babylon in relationship to the biblical word Babylon to describe America. Here you have the pig standing in the middle of the Pentagon, ready for overkill, missile between the toes, blood-sucking vulture with a dollar sign and drooling out the mouth, dollar bill signs on the glasses, hand grenade in one hand, AR-16 in the other, and then lynching rope in the other hand. So you had all this intensity. But at the same time, you had in New Haven, Connecticut, you had Bobby Seale and other Panthers, and Erica Huggins, another prominent Panther, who were charged with the murder of a Panther in New Haven, Connecticut, but were eventually exonerated of that, and the agent provocateur was found guilty, who created and did the murder. In Kent, Ohio, at the University of Kent State, you had four white students who were murdered on the campus by the National Guard protesting against the war in Vietnam. You had Augusta, Georgia. You had black students in Augusta, Georgia, Jackson, Mississippi, and on many other campuses. There were rebellions that took place on the campuses during that period. You had the Vietnam War. You had the struggle in Cambodia, Laos, and the struggle of the Palestinians. All of this intensity in that period of 1968. You also had John Carlos and Tommy Smith, who gave the black power sign. There were many discussions between the community prior to them going. They wanted to go there to show the basic human rights, express their feelings, concerns about the basic human rights violations against the African-American community. Of course, all the Olympians couldn't come to a consensus on what they should do. So when they went there, they gave the black power sign. Others did other symbolic things to demonstrate their concerns. In 1972, it continued on. You had Wayne Collette and Vince Matthews, two performers at the 1972 Olympics. And this was called at ease. When they won, they just stood on the podium. They just sat at ease. No flag, no, just there. This is an image that I did on the back of that paper called at ease. Here's one symbolic where I kind of wrote out the ideal of it, and then I interpreted in the illustration, broke it down, and it says the Olympics, and you have them get on the line, they run, they come to the winner, and then he stands up on the podium with the flag, and when he comes back home and when it's over, a nigger is a nigger is a nigger. No matter if you're a doctor, no matter if you're a lawyer, Olympian, you will be profiled in America. You just had recently, about a year ago, you had over 600,000 people of color, predominantly black in New York, profiled just because of the color of their skin. Come to find out, and they were trying to see if they found guns. They only found guns on less than 1%. But they found out that 45% of the white people who weren't being profiled were carrying illegal guns. This is to get out of the ghetto, get out of Africa, get out of Asia, get out of Latin America, U.S. imperialism. Ha, 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 good old American peace. Third world, Africa, Asia, Latin America. That to your left is Henry Kissinger, was then the Secretary of State. And to the right was Richard Nixon, who was the President of the United States. Both of them were criminals. Richard Nixon had to leave office in disgrace. Here's one, a quick quote from the Vietnamese, and it said, in Vietnam, the Vietnamese say, if the enemy refuses to get out, annihilate him. This is the U.S. nursing all these other little piglets. And this image just showed all these countries that I got names of, which would be, take the time to go into, were involved directly or indirectly in the colonization of other people of color in the third world. And so this image was first done in the Le Monde paper in Algeria, when we had, because we had an international section of the Black Panther Party for those who went into exile in Algeria in 1969, and we were also invited to the first Pan-African Cultural Festival there, where we met with many of the liberation and organizations during that period while there. There again is dealing with the apartheid state of Israel and how the United States government spoon feeds it in relationship to keeping it afloat. Right now, they just recently gave to the government, the apartheid government of Israel, $38.5 billion over 10 years for weapons of mass destruction. And the agreement is that they have to stop buying the other weapons from other countries and had to buy them directly from the U.S. That's a part of that agreement. Here's a little pig as a caricature, winding up his little toys, sending them off to war. And they get over there and realize they're fighting the wrong enemy, and they come back and turn on the little U.S. imperialists. And a lot of them joined the Black Panther Party. And it says, free the GIs. It says, our fight is not in Vietnam. The Vietnamese wasn't cause of unemployment. The Vietnamese wasn't cause of inferior education. The Vietnamese wasn't cause of indecent housing. The Vietnamese wasn't murdering us, lynching us. Our fight was not in Vietnam. Our fight was right here in the USA. Here is showing you what war does to human beings. War is devastating. Even today, you got 22 veterans committing suicide every day from the wars that's going on right now. So the psychological impact of war is devastating. Here's that same paper where we shared it with some young brothers called La Sieta de la Raza. These were Latino brothers who were charged with the murder of a San Francisco police, which they were eventually exonerated of. They had no lawyer, they had no way to plead their case, and we shared our paper with them, four or five issues, and so they could talk about the history of their case and what was happening. We even got them our lawyer, well-known lawyer, Charles Gary at the time, who defended them. And without that, and being without the lawyers, without all assistance from the community and rallying on their behalf, they probably would be dead in the gas chamber or still in prison today. Here's again a picture of seven of them showing the second front cover of that one of the issues. Boycott letters, we're in solidarity with Cesar Chavez and the farm workers. They were on their way to Sacramento and they came by our office in Oakland, California, and they were passing by and we heard them outside and we went out and we asked what was going on. And there was Cesar Chavez leading about 50 farm workers at that point and picking them up on the way. And they were going to Sacramento to protest against the chemicals were being toxic chemicals that were being sprayed on the produce, particularly the lettuce at that time. And so they needed a way. They were hungry and they wanted to eat. So we worked it out and arranged to take them to our office about 20 blocks away. And we marched with them to our office to our school. And they had lunch and then they continued on to Sacramento. And this paper was done to show our solidarity with that particular struggle at that time. This is about, we want decent housing fit for the shelter of human beings. Here we again is showing the sister protecting her baby from the rodents by shooting at the rat hole, and then you have the rats come around attacking the baby. It's meant to be provocative to bring attention to the issue. Here again is, whatever's good for the oppressor has got to be bad for us. And this says the pig ship is landed up on the moon. And it says, hey, hand them slaves with care. We're going to need them for Mars, Pluto, and all those other planets. Then you have the slaves coming off the slave ship saying, I knew we should have stopped this shit before it got off the ground. Then you got the pig over here with the pick and the handle saying, okay, goddammit, don't take 400 years this time. That's in relationship to our involvement in developing and building this country. Save the children. This could be this is Africa, Asia, Latin America, America today. Again, save the children. Here's one called Freedom and Playing Off the Conditions of Oppression. And it was that during the time when Erica and Bobby were incarcerated in New Haven, Connecticut, as I mentioned earlier. This is about self-determination, enlightening and informing and educating. Listen to them pigs banging on my door, asking me for some rent money. They should be paying my rent. Alabama, Georgia, Louisiana, Mississippi, California, Chicago, New York, Africa, New York, America, freedom is a constant struggle. I just want to testify, I'm not going to sit around any longer. I got freedom on my mind, freedom. We shall survive without a doubt. These were panther cubs in these images that you see. They're now adults in their 30s, late 30s or 40s. All power to the people. We had many social programs. We had free ambulance service. We had free health clinics. We had alternative schools, because they're one of the best alternative schools in the state of California. You had people like Rosa Parks who used to come and stay with us for a couple of weeks at our school. We had Aminata Masika, who was named Abby Lincoln, well-known jazz singer, came and did performances with the kids for several weeks at the school. John Lee Hooker, Sheila E., Santana, all those had done performances and celebrated with us at one point in time back during that time. This is called about sickle cell anemia. Fight sickle cell anemia was a disease that predominantly impacted the African American community in the United States, and there was no cure for it. And there was nothing being done. And you had these hustlers who were hustling off of it, so we took it over and began to enlighten and inform the community about the issue of sickle cell anemia, how it impacted the African American community. And at the same time, we had doctors and nurses who contributed their time in relationship to going out and doing outreach in relationship to where we did over 100,000 testing of regarding sickle cell anemia. And the disease was a sickling of the cell, and people get sick and they die from it. And you had a young brother, several people in the Panthers who didn't realize that was what they had until they took the test. And one young man wrote his book. And he said that was how he found out, was when he joined the Panthers and he was able to take the test. Then he began to realize what his health problem was. Black genocide, sickle cell anemia. Germ warfare declared against blacks. Hundreds of black men discovered massacred in the syphilis experiment. This took place in 1939. You had these black sharecroppers again who couldn't read or write. We put in this program, giving $50 each. By 1947, they had found a cure for syphilis. It was penicillin, but they weren't given the penicillin in the test. They were kept in the study until 1972. And they were going blind, dying, all kind of health issues, passing it on to family members and others. And in 1972, you had these progressive reporters who couldn't get the information published in the mainstream media at that time. So they gave it to us and to other alternative publications. We published it in our paper, and they published it. And it was in 1972 when that was exposed like that, that's when they discontinued the whole study. I think they did the same thing in, I think it was one of the other countries during that time, where they used the prostitutes, the soldiers, and others, and shot them up with germ warfare, you could say. Sterilization, genocide of the poor in third world countries, in the United States here and other places. Here again, we had a seniors program called Seniors Against a Fearful Environment, SAFE. And this issue here where we should take seniors, pick them up at the satellite houses, take them to cash their checks and get their groceries. They even had a program where our Oakland Community School became a cultural center in the evening, where they would come and they would decide on what produces and things that they needed. We would go get them voluntarily donate and bring it back, and they would pick them up at the school. But here again, we were talking about in Oakland, they were talking about spending $54,000 on a helicopter when we needed funds against a fearful environment. Now they're gonna spend $54,000 on a helicopter, patrol the community against crime. That ain't gonna stop crime. When they could take that $54,000 and invested in young people like we were doing, if they really wanted to cut into crime, and pay them to take the seniors to cash their check, pay them to take the seniors to do their shopping. If you want to cut into crime, you invest in the young people, not in helicopters. Vote for Survival, free food program. We gave thousands of bags of free food away, all over where we had chapters and branches. Today's news, ? Everywhere you go, you got homeless, all over. You got working homeless. Hypertension kills, I'm hungry, I'm unemployed, I'm black. This image of mine was beautiful poster was created by OSPAL, Organization of Solidarity with People from Asia, Africa, and Latin America. The Cuban artists during that period used to remix some of my images and reinterpret them and send them out into the third world in solidarity with the struggle during that time. And this is one of the images. I'm gonna show you where the two images came from in relationship to the next two. This is one of the images that they had, was a poster that they combined with the other image that you may see here. That's this one where they reflipped it and turned it around with the baby over the shoulder. Then the next one, this is the other one where they cropped it and put it together, made the two images, and made it into that amazing poster. Here again is one of the images that I done. This image was in the interior of the paper. It shows that they were reading the paper and they took it and did it with this amazing poster saying solidarity with the African American people, August 18th, 1968. And it's in four different languages. That's the image that you're seeing here. They flipped it around in the whole bit, which is a small image. Afro-American solidarity with the oppressed people of the world. Here again is dealing with the apartheid system of South Africa. And I had this book of bondage. It was the only book I had. And out of that image book, I used those images in the collage into the, a spark to light the purifier in relationship to what was going on with the apartheid system in South Africa. And out of that spark to light the purifier, you had this flame that ignites. And out of that flame that ignites becomes this freedom fighter, because it says repression breeds resistance. This one's it was an older image and a younger image, and I chose this one in relationship to including in the show here. It's a poem that goes, it said, we are soldiers in the army. We have to fight, although we have to die. We have to hold up the blood-stained banner. We got to hold it up until we die. My father, he was a soldier. He had in his hand the freedom plow. When he got old and couldn't fight anymore, he said, we got to get up and fight anyhow. My mother, she was a soldier. She had in her hand the freedom plow. When she got old and couldn't fight, she said, we got to get up and fight anyhow. Now, we all are soldiers, and we have in our hand the freedom plow. When we get old and can't fight anymore, we got to get up and fight anyhow. I, Gerald Ford, am the 38th puppet of the United States. That's what it is. It's been exposed. Your president is controlled by corporate America. We were talking about just 50 years ago. This was done on Halloween. It says, trick or treat, pigs, trick or treat. And that was Richard Nixon and Spiral Agnew, the president and the vice president. Both had to leave office in disgrace. Criminals running the government. Class brothers. I wonder if Nixon is bugging us now. I wonder if Obama is spying on us now. Because you know, a lot of people don't know, there's the FISA court. It's called the Foreign Intelligence Surveillance. And that's a private court where they can go and get this, and you don't even know that they're getting these orders to spy on the American people. And you never know it. They could tell you one thing, but they go to FISA court and they never turn it down. They never turn it down. They may revise it, but they don't turn down the order. Cautious, surviving is criminal. Event in two black men's lives. Dramatized why? Prison camps USA, the unknown slaves. Today it's the prison industrial complex. And it's about privatization, which they claim that they're doing away with, but privatization is about making money. If you're in the private business, you want to make money. You got to have a product on your shelf to make money. If you don't have enough product on your shelf, you don't make no money. So you're going to always try to have a product on your shelf. So that means that you're going to always find some people going to be incarcerated if they're in the private prisons because it's about making profit. Why must black people look at each other through prison bars? Where is our freedom? My suffering, my bitterness, my loneliness, I'm not going to let it get me down. I'm not going to let it turn me around. Maybe the young man has a family member that's incarcerated. George Jackson lived. George Jackson was a brother who was incarcerated as a common criminal, became very informed, enlightened, and became very political, lies in prison. He requested from Huey Newton, while Huey was incarcerated, to start the first chapter of the Black Panther Party inside prison. That was in San Quentin prison. Political prisoners of U.S. fascism, Huey Newton and Bobby Seale, the founder and co-founders of the Black Panther Party, during our period in time were the first of many to be political prisoners. Free the New York 21, Panthers also political prisoners. Athena Shakur's mom was a political prisoner, was a member of the Panther New York 21, Tupac's mom. Hallelujah, the might and the power of the people is beginning to show. This is done when Bobby Seale and Erica Huggins were exonerated of the murder charges in New Haven, Connecticut. This is called the murder of Fred Hampton, 1969, when the rage went on throughout 1969, when there was a whole period in regards to trying to destroy the party. And Fred Hampton was slaughtered. You can see the film called The Murder of Fred Hampton, and then you can see more. It's on YouTube, as opposed to going through the whole details at this time. And Mark Clark was the Panther, who was also of the Southern Illinois chapter of the Black Panther Party, who was shot through the heart when the FBI came to the door and instantly killed. And they tried to claim that he shot the gun and that's why they did the raid. But it was a police informant, a young man who stole a car, took it across straight lines. He had a federal beef. They told him that if he infiltrated the Black Panther Party, they'd make a deal with him. He was the one who worked his way up into security in relationship to Fred Hampton's bodyguard. And he was the one that gave the plans to the local authorities there in relationship to these raids that they did during that period. But if you want to know more, you look at the murder of Fred Hampton, and it would tell you the whole story. Carl Hampton, no kin to Fred Hampton, young man, 21 years old, head of the Houston chapter of the Black Panther Party, cleaned up the community, no drugs, no prostitution. Seniors could walk in the streets. They had done all that. Got in altercation with the local Houston police. They came back a couple of weeks later. Somebody told him that the police was out there. He went out into the street to see what was happening. They had allowed a police sniper to go up into a church tower. And when he went out, they shot him dead from the church tower. You also had Panthers in New Orleans. When you had the police came dressed as nuns and priests, and the young lady went to the door, they shot through the door. She was shot through the chest, but she survived. So this was the kind of things that the Black Panther Party was confronted with. Here's how we show our respect for the original caretakers of this land. We were in solidarity with AIM, the American Indian Movement, and all of those. They were our comrades. And now I'm going into remix images or newer images, except for this one is about homecoming. This is the first book of Sonia Sanchez, the well-known poet. She was out in San Francisco. I did the first cover of her first poetry book called Homecoming. And since then, I've remixed the image here again and also here again. But I call this Malcolm X the Warrior. I call that Malcolm X the Father. I call it Dr. King. You know, he was opposed to the war in Vietnam, and that's what got him assassinated. Because he said, you know, you don't know who I am. You know, he got off the track. They wanted him to be just a civil rights leader. But when he began to talk about the war in Vietnam and began to talk about the racism and all the exploitation of people of color for the interest of the wealth of individuals in this country, that's when they assassinated Dr. King. Even the mainstream civil rights leaders abandoned him when he took that position. It's, here again, black people were also sharecroppers in the same fields that the farm workers are working today. Here's a remix of an older image, and here he said, "Here we are living in the land of the plentiful, while we, the people, starve. People's free food program. Needed much today." This is a sister who used to buy her paper every week and sit out in the back of the central headquarters and read her paper. And so I just did this in honor of her. And this, I interpret the language to say, it's a darn shame how the government won't give us, the needy, a helping hand. U.S. government continues to starve poor people. Why? Billions of dollars worth of food is dumped into the ocean each year by the U.S. government. And that's a fact. They are dumping it into the ocean rather than give it away. This is a brother who wished to be slushed. He would be drunk, but he'd always come get his paper. He'd be swagging, but he'd come get his paper. And it says, "I know one thing. The next time I vote, it's going to be for people's power only. We've been lied to, murdered, jailed, brutalized, unemployed, neglected as infants, young adults, and senior citizens, forced to fight wars of aggression, manipulated to support wars against liberation." Here again shows many of the social programs that we had in the Black Panther Party. We had free busing programs. Somebody gave us a Greyhound bus. We took the Greyhound off and put the Panther on there and put a free busing program. That was in Chicago. We had cars and vans elsewhere where people could come in free to go visit loved ones in prison. We had a free ambulance service in Winston-Salem, the first chapter in the South, because the fact that the ambulance wouldn't come into the community in time or at all. So they got together and got certified as ambulance drivers, and the community helped them buy an ambulance. So we had the Black Panther Party Ambulance Service in Winston-Salem. Here you see the senior citizen program, free food giveaway, the alternative schools. All these things we were involved in, serving the people, body and soul. We want land, bread, housing, education, clothing, justice, and peace. This is Bluest Eye. This is about banned books when I was invited to be a part of an exhibit. And there's a whole 100 books that's been banned or censored in this country. This was Toni Morrison's book, Bluest Eye, that was censored in many parts and areas of the country. And in essence, what she talked about in the book was this young lady who lived in this fantasy world. Her mother didn't think she was going to be a beautiful child when she was born. She wasn't a beautiful child. Her mother thought she was going to have a rough time in life. And she was. She was abused, confronted with racism and all, and lived in this fantasy world. But on the last page, she said, Toni Morrison said something where she could have been assassinated. And then I said, to me, that meant, well, she could have been, you could be psychologically assassinated. You don't have to be assassinated by a bullet. You can be psychologically assassinated by life, life's journey. This is what I've seen and was able to interpret with this image. Here again, I was dealing with reparations. Greg Morizumi, Asian American, did his exhibit on Japanese-American and African-American reparations demands. And this is one of the images that I put in there for that. Here's again is one, reparations, spelled with the, using the figures to spell out the word reparations. But also this symbol here is a dugong symbol, West African dugong symbol. And it says, "You are a slave of him whose handcuffs you wear." There's a more recent one called Freedom. This was one done with Fabiana Rodriguez when we did some big, this was a big linoleum block print, 3 feet, 3.5 feet by 7 feet. I got 15 minutes. And so this is what I did in collaboration with her. Peace heals, war kills. I'll go a little faster. Peace, this is about Africa. Here is one called Peace. This is the world, the new world order, the same old order. Man made money, money drove man mad. That's the three M's. This is the 2012 election, both candidates spent over $1 billion. One spent $1 billion, the other one spent $10 billion. Now that kind of money don't come from you and I. That's not $25 donations. Black Scholar Magazine, 1989. They wanted to do an image that dealt with the politics of black politics then. And here you have, I come up with the jackass and the elephant, both eating at the same trough. Here you go, this is toxic waste. This is a snake, you know, two-headed snake, Democratic and the Republican Party. The Republican Party is bullying the Democratic Party, and eventually it'll be the other way around. That's a two-headed snake. Real talk, Mama, President Obama, sure can talk good. Yes, sweetie, it's his job to make us believe things will be okay and do those things. Kill list, he killed the kill list. He signed a bill, it's called the kill list, where they get together every week and they decide on who they're gonna kill and assassinate in the world. This is why he gave when he went to get the Nobel Prize. He gave a war speech. That's why he's Nobel. That's why it's a Nobel fraud. He didn't give a peace speech. He gave a peace or war speech. Afghanistan, Africa, drone warfare, intended collateral damage. WAR, war. Guantanamo, commander in chief. It wasn't for the pressure of the world and the community. Guantanamo wouldn't be where it is today, and it still ain't closed. But you had the American Psychological Association, which was involved in telling them how to torture in Guantanamo Bay. And you had medical doctors. You had medical doctors who were telling them during the torture. The American Medical Association was involved with all this. This is what war. War is devastating. You got people with depleted uranium and all other kinds of residue left over from war, with babies with two heads, four eyes, no arms, three legs, three arms, all this that we don't see on a daily basis. And we're talking about a perpetual war that's going on forever and ever right at this point. Peace is relative. Peace can be peace. Peace can be attacked. Peace is being attacked. Peace is being bloody. Can you let me know when I got 5 minutes? This is in Yemen. Crimes against humanity. The United States is in Yemen. They're giving the bombs to Yemen. They're in Yemen doing the killing. Millions food insecurity. Millions displaced. Thousands injured. Humanitarian import blockade, thousands dead, water shortage. And they're giving them the Saudis a new budget, military budget, of $100,000, I believe, or something like that. $100 billion, excuse me. War, frack. You know, some people say they don't believe in global warming, but it's something. I don't care if you don't call it global, it's something. This is the pipeline that's happening today. Arab, Muslim, Islam, US government coded word for terrorist hate discrimination. Black male, US government coded word for hate, discriminate, kill. As much as things change, some things stay the same. Why do they get to brutalize and murder us and we get to blame? Police terror, USA. Black Lives Matter, justice now. Black Lives Matter, life, love life, the beauty of life. This is a collaboration with Aboriginal artist Richard Bell in Australia. This is a 60-foot by longest wall by 16-foot. Here again is another collaboration in Australia, because Tony, the white runner with John Collins, Tommy Smith, took second. He was in solidarity with them, but a lot of countrymen weren't aware of who he was. And so they wanted to bring light to who he was, because he wore the badge for solidarity for Olympians for human rights. Not only that, he was blacklisted. He had the fastest time for the 1972 Olympics. But they wouldn't let him run because he was in solidarity with John Carlos Tommy Smith. Here again, that's Richard Bell that you can kind of see right there. This is about an Aboriginal well-known named Gary Foley, who was a well-known actress. Pardon me for being born into a nation of racists. Here's a work of mine that's been interpreted by the Zapatista Mayan Women Collective in Chiapas, in Zapatista. Been Chiapas 4 or 5 times. Did a lot of work out there in the community. They took in the 5 or 6 of my images, interpreted with Mayan and Zapatista images. We started a whole movement called Zapatera Negra, that play off of Zapatistas and Panthers, which is showing how both movements were inspired by the culture and aesthetics of those movements. Here's the images. I have the actual embroideries, but unfortunately couldn't bring them with me. We do show them off and on. This is in San Francisco. Here's the poster that was done by a young brother, hip-hop artist there. Here again, Zapatera, Zapatista dials also were included. This was a collective. This is where we went to paint a Zapatista school in the jungle. We're in the jungle. We had to sleep up here. No lights at night, bats coming in, all kinds of things. You turn on your TV, you just look, your computer turn, look on something on the screen, all the flies and bugs attacking, cut that off. And you have to go down, you have to go out the back door and go down the hill to the out, his and her outhouse to use the bathroom. There's a hole in the ground. And we were there for about 3.5 days for this one. And this is what we came up with the paint. We had to bring paint, we had to bring sleeping bags. They can't afford any of that, but they show love and appreciation. So I've been there 4 or 5 times. And this is what we're able to do within the 3 days. Here again is a store called in Tuxla, Zapatista store. And I was me standing where they were introduced me to the owners, to those who ran the store. And we came back and we painted this store a year later. And this is the painting of the store. This is a collective. This is about 18, 19 people, artists. From different parts of the world. We're working together on this. And we worked there 5 days and we roughed it. No bathroom, no toilet, no showers. I mean, it was rough, but it was fun. These are the Zapatista dials that were a part of the installation that you see up on the right up in here, what have you. That's one of my images I contributed to the mural project. These are 2 of the images. This is Yop Zianapa, the 43. The students were missing in Mexico. This is my visit to a school in Oakland recently of young people, which I do often, visit young people. This was also with young people, but this is in Urbiston, Manchester. This is in London, in England. And this is the exhibit that took place with it, amazing exhibit. Over 43,000 people came to exhibit from 2008 of November, October to 2009 of 2009. And I'm April. 5 minutes, you got 5 minutes, okay. This is the opening night of that reception. This is the collaboration with the Maori artists in New Zealand. I took these 2 symbols because I twist symbol and I wanted to figure out what's going to do with it. And I collaborated and had to put them together and make it look aesthetically pleasant. And this is what I came up with. Twist symbols mean we may go different ways, but we always come back together, the single twist. And this was the what I came up with. Overcoming depression is our path to unity. And that's the general meaning in Maori, which was interpreted for me. Been to New Zealand 4 or 5 times, did some work there. This is opening exhibition. As you see on the left, the title of the exhibit was If We Were to Live Here. And so what I took is I took the British flag and put it upside down at the bottom and took the Maori flag and put it at the top. Because I looked online, everywhere you go, where you look at things, the British flag always has to be at the top. The other flags have to be below the British flag or to the right of the British flag. So I was playing off that in regards to the theme itself. This is on the streets of New Zealand. These are about as tall up to the top of that screen. I was this first time when I Elam International School of Fine Arts when I was invited there. This is in Argentina, Tramarchi. Here again is the reception after that. Young people, this is about 5,000-6,000 young people at a major basketball stadium, and it's a whole weekend. Here, this is at the Lorraine Hansberry Museum and the Civil Rights Museum down in Tennessee, Memphis, Tennessee. This is in Portugal, exhibit, floors, or as you see the images where you go up. This is again another one I did with Fabiana Rodriguez in relationship to dealing with immigration. This one is in Amsterdam, dealing with the issue of Africans, those who are squatters and what have you. And the word means, in the harshest form, denied, not allowing them to come into the country, or not wanting them into the country. Free the land by any means necessary. Boycott, divest, down with apartheid. Here is again my contribution to a big mural in Oakland, California. Free the Land, there was 9 artists, 1 Jewish artist named Susan Green, a Japanese-American artist, Afrocentric artist, a Native American artist, and the whole bit were made contributions. This is the opening of the finishing of the artwork. Health is wealth, I like the saying, yes, none toxic. This is in solidarity with the Haiti struggle, resistance. This is when the cholera was feces was put into the water, and the UN refuses to accept the responsibility for the over the thousands and thousands of Haitians that have died, and close to 100,000 who are still ill because of this. Mama said HIV/AIDS is an act of genocide in Africa, and it's an epidemic in our community. Why? Because you can't get the generic drugs. Ain't no profit in it. Father's love, mother's love, mental bondage. You got 1% of these youngsters out here gang banging, talking bullets. Police say, I don't care, let them kill each other, don't care. Here is that same one. This is what a collaborator with the Maori youth in South Auckland in New Zealand. They like that image, and because they got gangs there, and they want to do, we interpreted that, and this is what they came up with. And it's now across from a library at one of the malls there. Endangered species. They don't realize they're coming in endangered species. They don't realize when they get into the prison system that they're getting into modern-day slavery. Prison industrial complex, private property. Free the Angola 3, Panthers who were incarcerated. One died in prison. One died as soon as he got out of prison. The other two got out over 43 years in solitary confinement or more. Eddie Conway, political prisoner released after 44 years of injustice. These are Panthers. I'm almost at the end. Mumia Abu-Jamal, well-known, famous Panther that you know, now suing the government in Philadelphia because of the fact that he has hepatitis C and there's a cure for it, and they won't give him nor any other prisoners the 95% curable medicine for the hepatitis C. Free political prisoners, Freedom Fighters USA, I'm about 2 minutes away. Fighters for peace, justice, freedom, particularly the struggle against recognized and cruel and oppressive conditions, government inhumane policies and actions. All power to the people, educate to liberate. All power to the people. Thank you.
everyone. I'm Molly Dersey, another member of Civilization. Oh, thank you. I just wanted to take a moment to introduce you all to Marissa Janae Johnson, who just joined Emory on stage. She's going to moderate the Q&A portion of the night. Marissa is a writer and a speaker based here in Seattle, working at the intersection of blackness, womanhood, and Christianity. Her work with Black Lives Matter has garnered international attention, and she is currently working on a book about her radicalization, which I can't wait to read. If you haven't read anything by Marissa, I suggest you look her up. She's an incredibly powerful writer. So go to Twitter. Yeah. If you don't have Twitter, ask the person next to you or behind you to tweet on your behalf. We're all family here. You can delete it later. Hashtag design lectures.
Yes, thanks for having me. And I'm sorry, I just have so much I want to talk to you about now after that presentation, and know that we can't get to it all, but I'm really honored to be able to talk with you. And I think just before we begin, the comment that I want to make that struck me the most, as you were going through your presentation and showing your images, that is both encouraging and really upsetting, is all of your images, particularly your historical ones, are still relevant. They're still the things that we're still fighting today. Every single image that you put up there has a modern equivalent right now that's either exactly the same, it doesn't need to be edited, or there are equivalents in this moment. And so even, you know, the images of Black mothers with their children with guns reminded me of an artist who created a beautiful image after Corinne Gaines was executed of her holding her child and a shotgun as well. And so I'm just kind of amazed and really thankful, and also it's disheartening to know that in a lot of ways we're still fighting every single one of the same struggles. So I have some questions for you of my own, and then we'll take some questions from the audience. And they're going to be for me and not necessarily for a design audience. Oh, well.
Okay.
I see one of the biggest challenges that we're having right now in terms of Black liberation and the movement for Black lives right now as political education. Even, you know, you talked about the athletes and John Carlos, and I was fortunate enough to be able to meet him a couple of years ago. And, you know, right now we have the athletes protesting the national anthem in the NFL. And so quickly the messaging there, right, has been warped a lot really fast. Do you have any commentary or any suggestions on ways that we can do better with political education, with how much just information that people have in the digital age and with social media?
That's a good question, and it's one that has to be, you have to try to do it in the context of relevancy today. And that's the challenge, but you have to, sometimes you have to walk again before you can, you have to crawl before you can walk.
Right.
So that means you have to go through the process of collectively trying to figure out the best ways how to do that in today, in relationship, and then sum up the experience and see how you can improve to continue it in relationship to informing and enlighten, but you have to use every possible means that you can.
Right.
And you have to be able to express that, but you have to be able to communicate it in a way that even a child can understand.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
You can't do it, it's the intellectual elitist kind of way, which is relevant to a certain group, a class of people, but you also have to be able to understand it so common folks can get the gist of what's being said. And I think in the context, we were able to capture, get into that with because of the way the people could see in the artwork something that was relevant, but they could see themselves as the heroes in the work. So that's very important too. But in a way that's not distorted, but in a way that they can see their uncles, their fathers, their brothers, their sisters, and through all the arts, not just the visual, all the visual arts, and the just has to have, you have to have, you have to be able to feel it in the same way that you feel music.
Mm.
You have to visualize it in that same way. So when people can look at it, they can getting a feeling from it, and that comes from putting in the work.
Yeah.
And it's a job, It ain't everything you do is not come out rosy and beautiful, but you have to adjust it up and critique. You have to be able to accept what the criticism that you hear in the context of what's being done and what's not being done. And you had to be willing to open up and to go back and try and improve what you do as well. So it's a whole lot of dynamics connected.
Speaking of criticism, one of my frustrations sort of in our current moment, and I don't know if this was true with your work with the Black Panther Party as well, but it's been really hard to have genuine and useful political criticism, because I feel like after the Ferguson rebellions in the mainstream world, there was a lot of Black unity. Don't say nothing about that person, because, you know, how do you navigate being able to have real, sincere political critique when the whole community feels like they're sort of like on a stage for white people and that we have to perform?
Well, you have to deal with issues. You have to deal with facts. Criticism and self-criticism has to be dealt with. Not based on blind emotion, but based on the facts. And whether it's agreed with or not, it's the reality. But once you put it out there, maybe perhaps as on some point, those who resist it may become enlightened and become understand what was being said, but you have to do it. You can't hold it back because somebody like Obama,
right?
You gotta say what the reality is of that situation. It's not about personal, it's not being personal. Right. It's about the issue and the facts that you're dealing with.
Yeah. Right. Yeah, I think we're, I think we're getting to a better place than in that, than we were a year and a half ago. But yes, I think it's a struggle. Mm-hmm. You talked a lot about the specific repression that you guys faced. And I'm sort of overwhelmed because I think people think that even if they're, a lot of people aren't aware of the repression, right, by the U.S. government that you guys faced. But even if they are, they think, oh, that was something that happened, you know, in the past and not something that happens now. And yet in my work with BLM, I've been followed home by the police, had my window smashed in. I just had a reporter contact me 2 days ago and found out that they were monitoring our phones 2 years ago. Things we already knew, right? But people called us crazy. I'm really curious for my own self, how do you not buckle under the pressure of repression and not have it make you too fearful to put your messaging out? Because that's been something personally I've had to try to navigate.
Well, you have, some people can only go so far. You've had people who were in organizations, Black Panther Party was, you have to understand, was not a movement, it was an organization, which was a part of a movement, but it was an organization that had a great impact on a broad scale of the movement in that context. But as an organization, you had people who could only go so far, and they couldn't go any further. You know, they left or you know, what have you. Mm-hmm. So you have to look at that as well. You know, in the context of accepting the reality, how you're going to move forward and continue to move forward, and that's always evaluating and understanding the human. You're dealing with human nature. Mm-hmm. You know, you're dealing with human nature. That means that how people and what they can do and what they can take is it has limitations sometimes.
Right. Yes. Thank you for that.
Yes.
I'm really curious how you got started doing the work that you were doing. You touched on it a little bit, but I'm interested how much of your political education you feel like happened before you started creating the papers and helping design the papers, or if a lot of it was building the plane while you were flying and you felt like you learned a lot.
Well, it started as a young person when you're in school and how you see how the teachers favor people of color as opposed, don't favor people, get the same treatment as the white students in the class. Or, and I remember my neighborhood in San Francisco when I was about, I'm 73, so that was in 2000, about 1955, around in that time, 55, 56, we had to wear dog tags because of curfew for almost 6 months to a year, you see, because the fact of being on curfew with your name, your age on it. So and then you see the civil rights movement, sit-ins, black entertainments, and Fillmore then could not stay at the hotels downtown.
So you seen them at the hotel in the Fillmore District where you live at, because they weren't allowed to stay at the hotels downtown. Same thing in Oakland. They couldn't have to stay in the black neighborhood. And this was in the 50s, you see. Mm-hmm. Only ones could stay downtown at the hotels was those who were working at jazz singers who sang at the elite Paramount Hotel, I think, a Fairmont Hotel it was mm-hmm. called. So you see all that, you experience it. Then you see a turn on the TV in the 60s, and you see internationally, you see the dogs being sicked in South Africa, in the tanks, and all those things taking place. Then you switch, and you see the same thing happening in Alabama and all over the country in the South. So you begin to formulate, those begin to formulate how you feel about things. And then as you evolve and grow, you get into the San Francisco State College, Junior College, about 64, 65, and the beginning of the Black Power, Black Conscious Movement, which is the Black Power Movement, defining for oneself. You call communists, you call everything, because you begin to want to identify yourself, and you want to change the name from the Negro Students Association to the Black Students Association, and then you call communists, all these kinds of things, you see. By the administrations and what have you. So you from that builds your consciousness and awareness, and because when you're working with other folks as well, you know, and then all those things are the foundation of development. But as an artist, I didn't do any political work as a kid. Yeah, I just like everyone else. I just picked up cartoons, wanted to draw and do all kinds of stuff on paper. I was in and out. I was bad. I was in and out of the youth detention centers. And I was suggested to go to City College of San Francisco. And when I did, the counselor suggested that I take up commercial art. And that was where I developed my only professional training, basic training I had as an artist. But I developed it to the point where they used to send me out on job assignments. And so skill-wise, but it was involvement with the Black Arts Movement at that time that I began to become informed and enlightened about historical figures in the struggles of resistance and what have you. And so that laid the foundation. At the same time, when I was talking to the intensity of the period, of like most people don't come into the movement because they're scholars or intellectual. They come into the movement because of the repression. And so you have a whole dynamic, a whole diverse group of people from petty class differences to coming in together behind these issues. And that's the same thing, I think. And that was the formulation, the way I began to formulate my desire in relationship to the artwork I did. But it was in the Black Panther Party around the 10-point platform program about housing, education, the prison industrial complex, war, all those things, that I began to develop my skills and abilities, because the artwork that I did at City College was not artwork that was the kind that you could put in your portfolio for a job. So I had to put that style aside in order to get a portfolio to go look for a job. You got a whole structure for that. And so I came.
My resume doesn't have my BLM work on it.
Yes. And so what happened is that I came back to what I did not, what I like to do, the style, when I came into Black Panther Party. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And so my basic training was City College of San Francisco, but then I developed, they sent me out on job assignments. But then also you worked in small community printing and design operations that don't have a budget of a high-end graphic design shops and what have you, but they have to take on jobs and do the same quality work as if they had all this access to resources and to do the work. Right. And so you learn how to cut corners. You begin to understand in a different way that you didn't learn in school how to create and develop. And so that was, and plus being in the Panthers, we had a limited budget. We only could, we had tables and we had some white paper and we had to have blue marker, non-photographic blue markers to square up to make our area where we're gonna lay out and cut and paste. We used glue and everything else. you, Marcus, and whatever we had to get it done. Yeah, and so, and we shifted for Fuqua, we had that. And sometimes we had come to the point where we got one of those smooth door tables and put them two horses on and laid it on that, and that became a layout table. So we used whatever we could, you know, until we were able to develop our operation, which became a 24-hour, 7-day-a-week, 365-day operation that also did community printing and graphics designing. So, and out of the experience of doing it, you learn, we evaluate, criticize the work, see how we can improve it as we go along. Sometimes it wasn't beautiful, it wasn't aesthetic, it wasn't clean and polished. So you have to look at that and see how you can do next time. Yeah.
Yeah, I'm definitely still in that process. Mm-hmm. And luckily the internet tracks all of your mistakes. Mm-hmm. So it's a really wonderful world. One of the things that I really appreciate about the work that you showed today in the Black Party, the Black Panther Party in general, is how consistent you guys were with connecting your messaging to conversations about imperialism. And I feel like that's one of the biggest challenges that we have now. And I'm curious, like, how you guys, if you have any advice or what specific struggles you came upon talking to Black folks about imperialism, because I find when we're talking with folks, they can kind of understand, right, like our own oppression, that's easy, you don't really have to, there's no big jumps, but then sometimes there can be this big roadblock, right, where people are really committed to nationalism in different ways, and like I said, we see that with the athletes right now in the NFL, right, it's all really wrapped up in sort of patriotism, nationalism, so I'm wondering, how were you able to, especially with your art, like how were you able to get past sort of people's indoctrination
We had great communicators and great people who knew how to break it down. Mm. Like we're saying, like to a child can understand it, and in paper, our paper as well. Because you had people come in the party who, and myself, I didn't understand imperialism, capitalism. Mm. I would evolve to understand what those symbolically represented, right, when I became into the party and what have you. But, everybody didn't come in understanding that. And that way, mm-hmm, you may have understood it in the context that you were being exploited. You may have understood it in the context of people being abused around the world, you know, those kinds of things. So if you talk about it in the common language, then you can get the gist of what that means in that context. And so that's the way it was broken down. It wasn't like talking about these terms and those terms. Right. That you see as scholars talk about. It has to talk about common everyday language to get the message across.
Yeah. Right, mm-hmm. Right. Okay, I've just been asking all my own questions, so I'm gonna check in real quick because I'm sure we have some questions here on the Twitter. Though I could ask my own questions all night. Okay, yeah, so it says, our first question is, you work in solidarity with other oppressed groups. You showed a lot with the Zapatistas. And I also want to point out that that's happening in our current movements right now. BLM and the Free Palestine Movement have been interconnected. I know right after the Ferguson uprisings, like there was solidarity between the umbrella protests happening in China and what was happening with BLM. And there's also been some connections with the Zapatistas and what's going on in Mexico. But this asks, how have you gotten involved with these projects, and why is it important to you?
Okay. Well, first of all, to make it clear, I don't market myself, and it's been people who are aware of the history and have invited me to be a part of, and I was invited to Chiapas by Caleb Duarte, who they had to do an artist in residency. It was the first time in 2012. They had an Idelo art space there in San Cristobal de la Casa. And I was invited there to come and do an artist residency, which I have a whole nother slideshow that shows all that as well. And that's when we did that painting out in the jungle at the school at that time. And we had, and the embroideries were unrolled, first shown during that period in time. In regards to, and people know of the work, my work. And so I remember I never, on Facebook, I just learned how to, had never looked at messages on Facebook. And so one time I looked at the messages on Facebook, and it was young folks from Argentina
Who do you said, have a Twitter account?
Hmm?
Do you have a Twitter account?
I forgot the code.
You gotta get. Oh man! All the good stuff happens on Black folks got their own little space on Twitter, and then we just go wild. We'll work it out. We'll work it out.
And so what happened is that they asked me if I would come to Argentina to Mar del Plata, where they do this whole program with these young folks. And they gave me the link, and I looked at the link, and I thought it was amazing. And I went, and they, for 3 days, they have this, at this major basketball stadium, they have nothing but young people from Brazil, everywhere from around Argentina. All the countries, they come there. And they participate in workshops and presentations, and in the quarter, they have all young people have their art and selling their goods. Outside, they have young musicians performing and skateboarding. And they say they started this at that time about 10 years ago, because they didn't have any qualified designers to teach them about graphic designing, so they started inviting people in. And it was there that when I did the presentation, as you've seen, after I did it, it was like you got 7 curtain calls, like you went to an opera or some of those things, and you stick up. And so it was there. After I had to figure that out, what was that? What was it? And what it was is that I came to realize that they could see in the artwork some of the same things that they're going through there and dealing with, maybe in a different context, but the artwork was a thing that connected us together. And so that was, and then I just had a show in Colombia, Bogota, Colombia, last December, was there, and met with a lot of the young people there, and Canada, so it's been ongoing, but it hasn't been something that I've tried to request or anything. It's people reaching out. And then I always try, another thing I do, I always request, when I go to these places, that I want to meet with young people, other people, to see what's going on. Mm-hmm. So I know what the reality is.
Right.
You see, so when we do these murals and stuff, we can integrate these things into the mural. Like when I was in Amsterdam recently this year, again, Richard Bell, and we did a thing at SMBA, the museum there, and it was around his project, dealing with the tent city that the Aboriginal did back in the day in relationship to their protest. And we work with the a group of young people there who call themselves the University of something like that, but they were not on the campus. They were off-campus organization. They were working with activists and students and what have you. And they were working with the African squatters there. Because you got a lot of African squatters that take over because they can't get housing.
Right.
And they're trying to push them out. And so they take over places. So they support them, and we met with them and the whole bit. They came in and collectively worked with us on the projects at the museum, doing the painting of the murals. And so you reach out to people that were in the mural you're seeing. We put the call out. And you had people who were muralists, those who never done murals in their life, who come in and work with us. So that way you're engaging people and raising consciousness and what have you. Yeah,
and I think that's some of the most amazing stuff about your work is that it's so translatable, because an image, right? You don't have to speak the language mm-hmm. to know what the image is communicating. So that's really awesome. I think that's really cool. Oh, yes, wonderful. I'm also really interested in this question. Were there any women designers, artists, creatives, which I already know the answer because throughout all the time, the answer has been yes, Black women, yes, always. But were there any women designers, artists, creatives directly involved in the creation of the graphics or artwork for BPP?
Oh, absolutely. Matter of fact, tomorrow, Tarika Lewis is in town. Her name was Matala, but she was the first artist I worked with. Even though I did 85% of the work, there was still a large volume of work. There was still a large volume of work done by the other artists as well. And my responsibility was to, and they were better artists than I, my responsibility was to show them how to integrate the social commentary into the artwork. And that was like each one teach one. Yeah. And so Matalaba, she's here at Aaron's, the program that's tomorrow, Aaron Dixon, who is the co-founder of the Black Panther Party in Seattle, is here. Yeah. Yeah. Gail Dixon was called Sally. He was another artist. So there were many artists, women artists in the party who I worked with. Yeah. And who work was in the papers as well. Yeah. And they're doing amazing work today. Yeah.
Black women always do.
Yes.
Just a side note. Always true throughout all of history. All right, we have another question. With the 50-year anniversary of the BPP coming up next month, what is your message? Sure, you have a lot, but what is your message to young people?
Come and attend and come enlightened and informed and hang out with the OGs.
Hey! That means we're going to have to get you up and going on Twitter.
Yes. But also, I like to people got to understand the Black Panther Party was broad, and it was it wasn't just Black Panther Party had people who were Christians, who were atheists. You had Muslims, you had Rastas, you had people just didn't believe in anything that made up the Black Panther Party, and it was a youth movement. It was a youth movement. The first cadre was 15, 16, 17, 18, 9 years, 18, 19 years of age. You know, the older folks, and I would think I was 21, 22, going on 23. I think Bobby Seale and Elwin Bigman Howard were the old folks of the party, and they were 28 and 30 years of age.
Ancient.
Yeah, ancient. Yeah.
Yeah, and I see that happening right now with what's going on with the Black Lives Matter movement. Is that I'm 25 and I'm ancient in the spaces that we're doing, which is really encouraged, especially in Seattle. There's a lot of youth who have done a lot of great work for Black liberation, and you know, people just got a bunker project halted here in Seattle. That I was reminded of when you showed the image with the helicopter, and you were talking about how I think in San Francisco that they wanted to spend money on helicopters.
That was Oakland. Yes.
In Oakland, maybe
yes.
It is Oakland. Yeah, and that's happened here with the bunker, which just got blocked, and the city's going to push it back, and you know, people will have to stay on them for that, and also a $210 million youth jail that they want to build that. People, and particularly young people, have been fighting for like almost 4 years now. Awesome. Okay, so we have another question. What is the power of graphic art to impact social change? What is the power of graphic art? We talked about this a little bit, but what is the power of graphic art to impact social change?
Well, it gives you a visual interpretation and a reflection of the dialogue or the politics or the issues that are being discussed, articulated through dialogue or whatever. So the art is a visual interpretation of those messages. But it's how you interpret it is how with the impact, and you will get that response from the masses of people and how they feel about it and what have you. And so that's how I would respond to that, yeah.
And I appreciated that a lot of your images, especially the earlier stuff that you showed, it didn't pull any punches. You're like, pigs out here, this is what they're about. Mm-hmm. There was no misconstruing.
The
messaging.
And that came about when I did that first illustration because of the commercial critiquing the work in as going to City College. I thought about it, and I said, why don't I send it up on two hoofs, keep the snort in the tail, and put the clothes on it? And that took on a life of its own. It became the iconic image that people identified with.
Yes.
And it was the feedback from people laughing and talking about it. And you have to be amazed how these images transcended class and color around, and you know, it just took on a whole life of its own. Yeah.
That's awesome.
But also I'd like to say too that a lot of people didn't know that there was an official chapter in New Zealand of the Polynesian Panthers. And you can see their story. You can go online to YouTube, and you see the Polynesian Panthers Panthers story. Mm-hmm. And some of them will be coming to the reunion in next month, October 20th, the official date, October 20th to the 23rd. Yeah. Mm-hmm. There were London Panthers. There were Australian Panthers. There were the Dalit Panthers. Right. There were even some Panthers in Palestine. Mm-hmm. And you had some even inside of Israel. A lot of people didn't know that as well.
And like we talked about with that last question, what I think is really powerful about the artwork that you did that really touched me and the power of art in general is that you are able to educate people politically, but it hits you at a different level, right? It hits you at an emotional level. And I have one last question for you, because we're about to wrap up time. Are there any younger artists right now that you really like, that you think we should look out for, or anything that you've seen that you want to put us onto?
I'm always asked that question. I always say I don't like to mention names, because you always leave somebody out.
Right.
So therefore, I said in the context, there are artists who are trying to figure out how they can put social commentary into work, and are doing it. Some amazing young artists are doing it everywhere.
Mm-hmm.
Just got to continue with it, and it's not about me, it's about we, mm-hmm. in relationship to how they may think about the art in the context of what they do. Get contemplating on those things and contemplating on it until you come up and realize how you going to do a we art.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Yep. Yeah. So go and find those artists and then give them money. And I do not mean this facetiously. I'm not joking. Go find these artists and give them your money. Support. Yeah. Financially. I would just like to say thank you so much, Emory, for being here, for talking with us, for letting me ask my own personal questions. And I think we're getting ready to wrap up here.
Thank you both for being here and sharing these stories.